region in comparison to the expansive landscape of the African continent. The landmass of the island does not contain us. Though physically bound on all sides by the sea, we're psychologically free to claim a much wider sphere of influence. Indeed, the sea functions, I believe, not so much as a constricting boundary, but as a waterway connecting the island to distant lands beyond its immediate shores. Especially if we think in terms of the Jamaican diaspora, all those Jamaicans with so many passports, legal and illegal, dispersed across the globe. And I know many of them have used Nassau as a transport, a point into the Caribbean, pretending to be Bahamians, you know. We are Anansi's children. We constitute a formidable transnational, constantly mobile state. The First Lady of Jamaican Culture, the Honorable Louise Bennett Coverley, affectionately known as Miss Lou, humorously acknowledges the Jamaican instinct for self-aggrandizement in her poem, Independence. Yes, dance. She mocks the song and dance of independence. Miss Lou, the ventriloquist, speaks through the mouth of Miss Matty, a self-important character she creates who loudly proclaims the benefits of the nation's newly acquired state of independence. Flag independence confirms an enlarged conception of both her own person and the landmass of the former colony. She hoped them cash and world map to stop draw Jamaica small, for the little speck can't show independentness at all. More so, remember, we must tell map that we don't like the position. Please kindly take me out of sea and draw me in the ocean. All right? She hopes they've cautioned the cartographers to stop representing Jamaica as small, for the little dot can't show our independence at all. Furthermore, we must tell the map makers that we don't like our position. Please take us out of the sea and put us in the ocean. And indeed, there's a whole body of reggae and dancehall music produced in Jamaica and the diaspora that traverses the ocean, exemplifying this expansive Jamaican sense of identity. It is a Pan-Africanist world that is celebrated. The mystic revelation of Rastafari with their tales of Mozambique, Buju Banton's African pride, Steel Pulse rallying round Rasta and the red, gold, and green, Third World's Lagos Jump, which celebrates Pan-Africanism as an erotic connection with a fine African woman, and President Brown's insistence that the sensual body moves of our contemporary dancehall divas should not be condemned, after all, as he puts it, is an African thing. So coming now, my selector Charles, first with Buju Banton's African Pride. All right, Africans with African pride, let us all unite. And the next one from President Brown, track two. Scrape it is an African thing, earring in our ears is an African thing, my youth. Africa is where we're from and that's where we belong. Africans and Jamaicans, we all are one, so let us beat the drum and sing this song. Now, Peter Tosh's anthemic African is, I believe, the finest articulation in Jamaican popular music of Pan-Africanist ideals. Don't care where you come from, as long as you're a black man, you're an African. Now, let us generously forgive Tosh for the conventional use of man to include woman. It would be far more sensible in popular usage to allow woman to signify androgyny, After all, man is wombed in woman. But let us leave aside this feminist red herring. What is much more pertinent is the way in which in the first stanza, Tosh uses African as a marker of racial identity. So run the track for me now. Thank you, my selector. All right. Now, in Jamaica, it is only people of African descent who do not define their racial identity in terms that denote ancestral homelands. Europeans, Chinese, Syrians, and Indians are all raced and placed in their very naming. It is only Africans who are generically black. Africa has been so dehumanized in the colonial imaginary that relatively few Jamaicans want to identify themselves as African. Many obviously pure black Jamaicans routinely claim ancestors of other races, usually distant great-great-great-grandfathers who have left no visible traces on the body of their doubtful offspring. And even in cases where some racial admixture is evident, the African element in the mix is always a half that has never been told. Mixed race Jamaicans are half Indian, half Chinese, half Syrian, half white, but never half African. Now, I would admit the possibility that this unnaming of the black half may signify that African is grudgingly conceded to be the unacknowledged norm. But much more likely, this silence may speak eloquently of the unresolved question of race and the contested status of African people in Jamaica. Consider, for example, the Jamaican names for two mixed-race categories, Chinese Royal and Coolie Royal. The Dictionary of Jamaican English defines